Let me welcome all of you today to the revival, time for a moral revolution of values, and the announcement of the national higher ground, moral higher ground declaration day of action on September the 12th. And I will be talking more about that in just a moment. Before we say anything, I want to ask the Reverend Dr. Graylin Hagler, our good friend and brother, the United Church of Christ, if he would come and open us today with a word of prayer. Would you?
Good morning. I want to thank everybody for being here, Dr. Blackmon and Dr. Barber and Dr. Forbes and everybody else, the clergy that are gathered here today. As we do from our tradition, where we draw upon our power, let us join in a moment of prayer. We just want to thank you, first of all. Thank you for just being God and watching over us and filling us with a spirit to do right, a spirit to go forward and bring forth your justice and your hope, to lift up a mighty cause so that people are united and blessed in the process of being united, because we stand here today for justice, and we stand here today for hope, and we stand here today so that the nation can change its ways and do that which is righteous and right, to protect all of those on the margins, to care for the poor, to empower those who need to have empowerment, so that there is a spirit of justice that becomes pervasive in this land, that we truly live towards the creed that we're called to live towards, that all people might find that place of joy and happiness, that each and every one might be secure and each and every one might exist in a state of justice and hope. Now bless us in all of these endeavors, particularly as we go forth towards September 12th. Allow us to feel your sacred and wonderful spirit, and allow us to be on fire with the light of justice and on fire with the spirit that brings about peace. In all these things we pray, amen.
Amen. At this time, we're going to open with a special promo video that's connected to the revival, time for moral revolution of values, and specifically talks about the higher ground moral declaration day of action. There are over 2,000 scriptures in the Holy Text. They talk about how nations should lift up the poor, children, immigrants, strangers, women, the sick, the bruised, and any who have been made to feel unacceptable. These things are at the center of a moral consideration. And we call on a resistance to the divide and conquer strategy of extremism.
We are here to promote moral values in our nation.
Our silence has contributed to the place that we are in right now. Our refusal to speak out across party lines, across racial lines, across gender lines, against what we know to be wrong, the faith community has been complicit in this cover-up.
Where is our moral voice? Where is our willingness to stand up and say enough?
So these prophetic leaders are resurrected to continue the movement, but that's only after this kind of public execution, this public crucifixion at the hands of the oppressors.
The way to change what's happening in our society is by letting our hearts be broken open by the anguish and the truth. In having it broken open, then there's room for everyone.
If we manage to help people recover the moral and spiritual values that were at the heart of their faith and our Constitution, America just might make it through this trouble.
We must shock this nation with the power of love. We must shock this nation with the power of mercy. We must shock this nation and fight for justice for all. We can't give up on the heart of our democracy. Not now, not ever. Vote together, organize together, fight for the heart of this nation.
So much. This promo is being released today, and let me just welcome all of you in the grace of God and the spirit of love. I first want to say how humbled I am to be walking with all these clergy who represent thousands around the country. I see my good friends with Fight for 15, FCIU, and others who have been a part of this work, particularly around the September the 12th action. The Higher Ground Moral Declaration that I'm going to talk about has now been signed on by 2,585 clergy across this country, representing Christians, Muslims, Jews, and other faith. We've also had persons who are not necessarily of faith, but who believe in a moral arc and a moral universe, and nearly 11,000 citizens and activists have signed on with representation from all 50 states. It has been my life's privilege to travel across the country. For those who may not know by TV, my name is Reverend Dr. William J. Barber II, and I'm president of and senior lecturer of Repairs of the Preach, pastor of the Greenlee Christian Church, and also author of the Third Reconstruction, Moral Mondays, Fusion Politics and the Rise of a New Justice Movement, that is a part of the story of the Moral Monday movement, where tens of thousands literally have joined together in one southern state and then in other states across this country, but particularly in North Carolina, and over 1,000 people have engaged in civil disobedience. And in February of 2014, over 80,000 people showed up and the largest march for civil rights and justice and equality in the South since Selma. But be all that as it may, and even my work with the North Carolina NAACP as president, it's been my life's privilege, and I've learned so much traveling with Reverend Dr. James Forbes, Jr., who's here today, the senior minister emeritus of the Riverside Church in the city of New York. He served as senior minister of that renowned pulpit for more than 18 years. He's a nationally and internationally known speaker, preacher, and teacher, and was named as one of the 12 most effective preachers in the English-speaking world by Newsweek magazine, and is the president and founder of Healing of the Nations and also the Drum Major Institute. It has been such a privilege to travel with him. I would make other one announcement, but he told me not to do it, so I'm gonna leave that alone for right now. But today is a special day, amen. I've been privileged to travel with the Reverend Dr. Traci Blackmon, who is the acting executive director, minister of the UCC's Justice and Witness Ministry. She was appointed to the position by a unanimous vote of the UCC board in October 2015. She's also the 18th installed and first woman pastor of the 156-year-old Christ the King United Church of Christ in Ferguson, Missouri. She has gained international and national recognition, particularly around her fight for social change when Michael Brown was shot in Ferguson, and is one of a stalwart prophetic voices in the world. It's been a privilege to join with Sister Simone Campbell, who has served as the executive director of Network since 2004. Most of us know her as Nuns on the Bus. She's a religious leader, attorney, and poet with extensive experience in public policy and advocacy for systemic change. And she lobbies on issues of economic justice, immigration reform, and health care. We've also been privileged, and this is kind of the four legs to this table, the Reverend Dr. Liz Theo Harris, who is a professor of New Testament at Union Theological Seminary and also the director of the Kairos project that is working to continue the work that Dr. King began when he talked about the poverty, poor people's campaign. Of course, today we opened up with our dear friend, the Reverend Dr. Hagler. I called, and brothers and sisters who are here, I call him the DC contingency. And so the revival time for a moral revolution has been coordinated by Repairers of the Breach, Healing of the Nation, the Drum Major Institute, and Kairos Center. But we also have great support. The Unitarian Church has been great in the support, the UCC Church, Disciples of Christ, Quakers, the Reformed Jews, and other Jewish bodies, Muslims. That we've had great support from Ask Me, from the Fight for 15, and from other bodies throughout the Sam Proctor Conference have all been great support. Auburn University, Union Theological Seminary, and the list continues to grow. Now, why are we here today? On Monday, September the 12th, at 11 o'clock a.m. in every time zone, clergy will lead a higher ground moral day of action outside of state capitol buildings and city and the city hall in the District of Columbia. So it will be in state capitals, and here in the District of Columbia, it will be at their city hall, because as you know, we are still fighting for states right here in the District of Columbia, which continues to be one of the great moral challenges in our country, people who have taxation without representation. Now, the Higher Ground Moral Declaration will make three declarations. One, faith leaders, advocates, activists, and people who have been hurt and impacted by regressive extreme policies and extremism in our political system will hold rallies outside of state capitol buildings and city halls to deliver the Higher Ground Moral Declaration. And it is a moral policy framework to respective governors, U.S. senators, presidential candidates, and candidates for office and major parties. You can find this Higher Ground Declaration at www.moralrevival.org, and I'll talk some more about this. The goal is to have clergy and impacted persons and activists to march together to these state capitals, to symbolically, since that is the center of power in each state except in the District of Columbia, to make the moral declaration by having impacted patients talk about how extreme policies have hurt them, and then each clergy will actually read this declaration. It is a nationwide petition calling our government, our political systems to higher ground. Number two, the second declaration will be communities of faith and deep moral consciousness will be called on to go to the polls this November and beyond and to vote for candidates that have the highest capacity to advance moral public policy agendas. And then number three, the third moral declaration will be on to call on religious leaders on two weekends prior to the presidential election and many state elections to call on faith leaders to preach and teach in their churches, their synagogues, and their mosques and other places of worship, with a focus on economic liberation for all people, ensuring that every child receives access to quality education, health care, access for all, criminal justice reform, and ensuring that historically marginalized communities have equal protection under the law. The Higher Ground Moral Day of Action is being coordinated in over 25 capital cities. We're working in conjunction, as I said, with our anchor groups in all of those cities where we're traveling to do these social justice revivals. Also with many of the members of the Fight for 15, who is one of the strong movements in our country now that's intersectional and brings people together across race, class, gender. They will include Montgomery, Alabama, Little Rock, Arkansas, Sacramento, California, Denver, Colorado, Hartford, Connecticut, Washington, D.C., Tallahassee, Florida, Atlanta, Georgia, Springfield, Illinois, Indianapolis, Indiana, Frankfort, Kentucky, Baton Rouge, Louisiana, Boston, Massachusetts, St. Paul, Minnesota, Jefferson City, Missouri, Concord, New Hampshire, Santa Fe, New Mexico, Raleigh, North Carolina, Carson City, Nevada, Albany, New York, Columbus, Ohio, Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, Columbia, South Carolina, Nashville, Tennessee, Austin, Texas, Richmond, Virginia, Madison, Wisconsin. Groups of clergy, 50 to 100 clergy with 50 to 100 activists and impacted people will be the anchor groups. Others may join, but that will be the anchor group that will go to these state capitals, make the moral declaration, will actually march around or on the area the state capital is located. And this declaration will be delivered both through hand copies and through email to senators, sitting senators, candidates for the Senate, sitting governors, candidates for governor, and others. The Higher Ground Moral Day of Action, as I said, is a part of the revival, Time for a Moral Revolution of Values, which is a national multi-state tour to redefine morality in American politics. The revival challenges leaders of faith and moral courage to be more vocal in opposing harmful policies that disproportionately impact vulnerable communities. As I noted earlier, the Higher Ground Moral Declaration has already been signed now by more than 2,000 clergy and more than 10,000 people of faith across this country who understand that we need to advance a moral agenda. That agenda includes democracy and voting rights, poverty and economic justice, workers' rights, education, health care, environmental justice, immigrants' rights and xenophobia, criminal justice, LGBTQ rights, warmongering, and how we address the issue of extreme militarism. We are very clear that the time has come to challenge the limited view of morality often put forth by the so-called religious right or the so-called conservative evangelicalism. As pastors and trained theologians, we understand that any notion of evangelical to be biblically consistent must begin with a critique of systems that create poverty, injustice, inequality, and declares that certain people are less than other people. Somebody must stand up and say, it doesn't matter which party is in power, who has a political supermajority once elections are over. There are some things that transcend political majorities and mere majority politics and the narrow categories of liberal versus conservative and Democrat versus Republican. There are some things that must be challenged because they're wrong, they're extreme, and they're immoral. But before elections are over, people of faith, people who have a deep moral conscience must be engaged. We cannot simply judge candidates by whether they had a photo op here or photo op there. We must look at policy, and how that policy lines up. When we look at, for instance, in the Jewish text, Isaiah chapter 10 says, "Woe unto those who legislate oppression and rob the poor of their rights and make women and children their prey." Or we go, for instance, to the New Testament, Jesus' first sermon, first evangelical sermon, where he laid out the kinds of concerns we ought to have in the public square. He talked about the poor, the sick, the blind, the broken, the hurting, and everybody who's been made to feel different, made to feel strangers. He said we must declare an acceptable year of the Lord. And at the closing of Jesus' life, he said nations would be judged by how we treat the least of these, the poor, the hungry, the thirst, those in prison. And so we believe we must expand, we must redefine morality in the public square. We can no longer just accept when we talk about moral issues, the conversation is simply about prayer in the school, where you stand on abortion, where you stand on homosexuality, where you stand on the Second Amendment, and where you stand on property rights and tax cuts. We believe from our deepest religious values and our deepest constitutional values, because even our Constitution does not begin with the things I just listed. Our Constitution says that our deepest moral principles, first of all, is an understanding of we, not simply about I and mine. And then secondly, the establishment of justice, the providing for the common good, the promoting of the general welfare, and the insurance of domestic tranquility. Those are the great moral tenets of our Constitution, and faith and justice and love and mercy and equality are the great moral tenets of faith. So someone must say, it is extreme, morally indefensible, and constitutionally inconsistent for us to make it harder for people to vote. That's immoral. It's extreme and immoral not to address systemic racism and to pay workers a living wage and to guarantee labor rights in a country that declares equal protection under the law. It is extreme and immoral. 100 years after Teddy Roosevelt talked about health care for all, and more than 2,000 years after Jesus and always set up free health clinics wherever he went, never required the leper to pay a copay. It is extreme, we believe, for politicians to get elected and get free health care after they get elected, but then fight to ensure that all people get health care. It is extreme to raise taxes and fees on the poor and the working class and to make college students pay more interest for loans while we cut taxes for the wealthiest in our society. It is extreme, 62 years after Brown versus the Board of Education, to see resegregated high poverty schools be the major challenge in our country and to underfund public schools on the one hand while we set up voucher schemes to fund private corporations on the other. It is extreme, it is morally indefensible, constitutionally inconsistent to pledge one nation under God, indivisible with liberty and justice for all, but then to fight against liberty and justice for the LGBTQ community, for immigrants in our country, and to seek to put laws in place regarding immigrants. And they're, instead of being welcoming to them, we see politicians seeking to put laws in place that if they were in place 100 years ago, their own ancestors would not have been able to be immigrants in this country. It is extreme to care more about the Second Amendment and how we can proliferate the ability for people to get assault weapons and guns than we fight to ensure people can get a voter card. It's something extreme when you can get a gun easier than you can get a voter card. It's extreme to claim that the legitimate discontent against police brutality and killing of unarmed blacks is anti-police and somehow just a black thing when we see black, white people, Latinos, Jews, Christian Muslims, all marching and declaring Black Lives Matter. It's extreme to castigate certain religions for political purposes. It's extreme not to love the Palestinian child and the Jewish child. And we believe it is a necessity for the this destiny of our democracy that we realize that we need a revolution of values. We must raise our moral discontent and dissent, knowing that whether we are heard now or heard later, history has shown that moral dissenters sow the seeds of change and justice that eventually blossom on the landscape of our democracy. Lastly, 1 year before his assassination at the pulpit that Dr. Forbes pastored for 18 years, Dr. King called for said it was time to break silence about militarism, materialism, and racism. This was after the Civil Rights Act of 64, after the Voting Rights Act of 65. He knew that the work in this country, the moral work, was far from over. He said then that silence was betrayal. We declare today, if silence was betrayal in 67, then a moral revolution of values, a higher ground declaration, is a necessity today. Yes. Lastly, I want to read one other scripture that even comes from the Quran. You heard me quote the Jewish text from Isaiah 10 and the Luke text from Luke, the text from Luke 4, but even in the Quran it says the believers, both men and women, are in charge of and responsible for one another. They all enjoin the doing of what is right and forbid the doing of what is wrong. Wherever you look, our deepest faith traditions, or even in our Constitution, there is this call for a higher ground moral declaration. We believe that the conversation we ought to be having right now in this country, whether it's presidential, gubernatorial, Senate, is where do candidates stand on these issues? Pro-labor, anti-poverty, anti-racist policies that build up economic democracy through full employment, living wages, the alleviation of disparate unemployment, a just transition away from fossil fuels that makes sure that the people who have worked there are not thrown aside, labor rights, affordable housing, direct cash transfers and social safety nets and other support for all families struggling to get by, fair policies for immigrants, and critiquing policies around warmongering that undermine our moral standing and our ability to address domestic issues. Number two, equality in education. That should be a focus. Where do you stand if you're running for president or you're running for governor? Where do you stand on equality in education? By ensuring every child receives a high quality, well-funded, constitutional, diverse public education, access to community college, university, equitable funding for minority colleges and universities. Where do you stand? If you want the people's vote, what, do you believe health care for all is a moral issue? Expanding Medicaid, ensuring Medicare and Social Security, but then moving towards universal, transparent, equitable health care for all and providing environmental protection. Do you, Mr. Politician or Ms. Politician, see environmental protection as a moral issue? Do you see protecting women's health? Do you understand that there's a problem that people can buy lead-free paint but can't buy lead-free water? Do you understand? Do you believe that fairness in the criminal justice system, by addressing the continuing inequalities and inequities that operate in that system against black, brown, and poor white people? Do you believe that fighting the proliferation of guns is a moral issue? Do you believe voting rights and expanding voting rights and protecting voting rights and women's rights and LGBTQ rights and labor rights and religious freedom and immigrant rights and protecting and never backing up on the fundamental principle of equal protection under the law are moral issues? If you don't think they're moral issues, then don't debate them. But say to us whether you believe these are moral or immoral issues. They can't be both ways. We believe our moral traditions have a firm foundation upon which to stand against the divide and conquer strategies of extremists. And it's time that we claim higher ground, higher than left versus right, higher than Democrat versus Republican, higher than simple partisan debate. But we understand that some things are not about partisan debate. They are about what is right and what is wrong. Every politician in this country makes a big deal. That's all right. That happens to the best of. We're prophetic people that believe in dancing and standing for what's right.
And the song was, "I'm guilty of doing wrong."
All right, well, that's a sign. And normally we would have a song, right? Because the book of Kings says that the prophet cannot speak until the minister. So it says, what was the song?
Jesus just dropped the charge.
I'm guilty of, and the song said, "I'm guilty of doing wrong." So, right, if we repent some of these charges, we will be able to rise in this culture. But this book, finally, this Bible, you know, every politician wants to put their hand on a holy book, and they swear themselves in the office. This Bible is called the Poverty and Justice Bible. The reason why is because some people went through and marked every scripture that has to do with how you treat the poor, the least of these, children, how you address the issues of poverty, right? You know what they found? 2,000 scriptures. Some of the things we often hear, the call of morality in the public square, Dr. Forbes, you can't even find a scripture. And some of them, you only find one or two. And none of those one or two scriptures trump this one. You must love your neighbor as yourself and treat the least of these right. It's time for a moral reset in this country, and that's why the revival is calling for a higher ground moral declaration on September 12th. I want to ask Dr. Forbes and Dr. Blackmon in that order to come, and then we're going to take questions from members of the media. Thank you so much. God bless you.
Brothers and sisters, in a few days, America will be commemorating the horrible and tragic events of September 11th, 2001, when the twin towers of the World Trade Center came crashing down from the brutal attack of terrorists. During the mournful days of shock, grief, vulnerability, and fear which followed, I recall hearing the singing, God Bless America, at Broadway plays, baseball games, and numerous public assemblies. As the song goes, and you can remember hearing at the baseball game, as we raise our voices in a solemn prayer, God bless America, land that I love, stand beside her and guide her through the night with a light from above. As we come, today's first day after Labor Day, to the home stretch of the presidential election campaign, our nation needs to be singing that song and praying that prayer in earnest out of the sincerity of our troubled hearts. Once again, 2016, 15 years after 2001, fear, anxiety, and assorted vulnerabilities hang like the dark gray clouds that were hanging over New York skyline, but it's hanging now all over our country, villages and urban centers. And the cloud, well, the cloud of, well, terror, foreign and domestic, threaten our sense of safety and well-being. It's a cloud. Also, this is a cloud too for some people, a new demographic with demands for equity and justice. Those clouds make the future seem fragile and uncertain for many, and makes democracy seem like a too costly, risk-laden experiment with an unrealistic utopian ideal. And disparate ethnic, economic, and political interests threaten to shred the social contract, untying the terms contained in it that made the United States one body, but is now making it look more like body parts. We need to pray, God bless America, land that we love, stand beside us right now and guide us through the night with a light from above. But to pray God's blessings and to remain indifferent or adversarial to moral and spiritual values of justice, mutual respect, compassion, and care for the poor, the disadvantaged, and the other, to pray and be indifferent or adversarial reveals what we've been working on, a serious character defect, moral degeneracy, and spiritual anemia. There are signs all around us that we need a moral revolution of values in our nation. Dr. King suggested that we have become captive to the triple evils of racism, materialism, and militarism. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Now, anybody with eyes that are open, we see more clearly than ever before how truly prophetic Dr. King was in his description of our national malaise. Take, for an example, racism. Mm-hmm. Folks, just think of the outrageous hysteria occasioned by the presence of a black family in the White House. And it's lasted for the entire two terms.
That's right.
Racism. Just think of the xenophobic passions fueling the current immigration caustic conversation. Or consider the police community manifestations of brutality and the resulting mistrust. And mounting video evidence and daily data-supported statistics that there is racialistic malignancy in every system and aspect of the American way of life. I think we're going to need a moral revival. And materialism? What is it in America that's not for sale? Assorted favors, sex, the political process, politicians, preachers, football players and their heads, body parts, market share, prisoners, votes, life and death for hire.
Yes, sir.
Our currency is imprinted in God we trust, but is it really true that in general, money is God in our nation?
All right.
Money has more influence in regards to our values, our political affiliation, our social arrangements. Market values,
mean
more than morals or our mamas. And greed. Greed. I used to talk about greed in regards to money buying elections and gun legislation and money determining attitudes regarding health care and prison industrial complex, international alliances. But you and I were at Union Seminary, and the Roman Catholic priest, Father Wright, quoted a scripture. I had to go home and look it up myself. And I just want, since we're in revival, it's okay to use the Bible. I know this is the, you know, club where you talk politics and stuff, but there may be a moral dimension.
There may be a moral dimension.
I couldn't believe this. I'm going to read it because I don't think people will believe this in the book. They would think we just concocted this for the revival. But it says right here in Matthew 5. I see it right here.
They said they want to hear you on the microphone.
You want to hear me on the mic?
Yeah.
Listen, in Matthew 5, 21 and 22, it said, "You have heard that it was said of those in ancient times, you shall not murder." I'm talking violence now.
That's right.
Murder. We know murder is violence. And Lord knows we've got it in the streets. That's why we keep on talking about Black Lives Matter, White Lives Matter, Jewish Lives Matter, Muslim Lives Matter, Gay Lives Matter, Old Folks Lives Matter. Yeah, I like to think so. The old folks' lives matter. Okay. But whoever murders shall be liable to the judgment. Listen, but I say unto you, that if you are angry with a brother, anger all over the place. Every time you turn on the television, radio, anger. And there are people who are so glad that there's somebody that's angry that expresses my anger. Anger. But if you're angry with a brother or sister, you are liable to judgment. And then the priest said, and if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, you fool, you will be liable to the hell of fire. And he ended up saying, you go around calling folks fools. You may go to hell. I heard that said someplace. But anyway, that's enough maybe for me to say, except there are two other things I want to say, and then I'll be through. We in trouble, folks. And the problem is that a whole lot of folks don't know what to do about voting. Voting is God's way of telling us how important we are.
That's right.
We are made in the image and likeness of God. Yes. And even God says what we name things will even matter.
Yes.
Therefore, it's important for us to understand that this is no simply political process at work.
That's right.
That when the issue of voting comes, we are determining whether we believe the snake on the ground or the God that made us.
Yeah.
We got to make up our minds. And so, Reverend, I don't know how we get this done. The reason we are going across the country day by day, it looks like September, the whole month, September and October,
the
whole month we're going to be doing, it's because I've discovered that while there is an election November the 8th, and everybody better vote, if anybody doesn't vote, it's because they ain't paying attention to God. They rather follow the guidance of a snake than to pay attention to God that says, you're my child, and I put voting power in you, and anybody that messes with it ain't nothing but a snake anyhow. But more than that, every day there is a referendum. Mm-hmm. That's why we have to go every day. I wish I could get a break. Can we get a break? But every day we have
every
to go.
Day, yes.
Because there is, folks, a referendum. It's a moral referendum. And it doesn't wait until November the 8th. Yes. And the way you vote on November the 8th is going to be based on what you do about the moral referendum. Yes. And that happens every day you get up. Because every day we get up, we are faced with a decision. God made the universe, said it was good, and then arranged for it to be held together. And there are the folks who are trying to pull it apart. And every day you get up, you're going to have an opportunity to cast your vote in the moral referendum.
Yes, sir.
I want to ask you this question, and I'm sitting down.
Sir. Yes, sir.
We are God's children.
Yes.
You seek to live your life without paying attention to what matters to God in regards to how we treat one another. In regards to how we spend our money, in regards to how we form our alliances and our association. If you make a vote every day, does it matter more to you what God thinks about it than what the snake thinks about it? That's a vote right there. Other is, God made us as one people.
That's right.
Question. Some folks try to do what we call pseudo-subspeciation, a big word for saying that we are one species, but that some are more human than others. And others have actually taken some human beings and made chattel property out of them,
yes,
or treat other people as second-class citizens.
Yes.
Every day you get up, you will see signs of folks that are parceling out human beings and putting some in a lower category, lower stock. You got to make a vote every time you see it. Am I for that or am I against it? And finally, God had a dream. It wasn't just Dr. King that had a dream.
Right.
A dream of the kind of world that God wanted to see. And every day you get up and walk out of your house, you're going to look on the world. And you've got to vote. Is this the kind of world I want to be in? Or is the world I want to be a part of, and the world I'm planning to work for, the world that the Creator dreamed
That's right.
Yeah.
from the dawn of creation?
That's right.
I'm going to leave here today. I'm going to the train station back to New York. Every time I get a chance, I'm going to vote today. And if I can vote right each day between now and November 8th, I'm not going to have to worry who to vote for.
That's right.
When I get there.
That's right.
Right.
That's right. That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's exactly right. Why it's been my privilege. Dr. Black.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Dr. Forbes reminds me that the last time I was in the press club, I was here with a rabbi who enlightened me by sharing with me that in the Hebrew language, the word kol, Q-O-L, is the word that translates voice, and it is also the word that translates vote. That every time you hear the word voice in Hebrew scripture, that you could easily say that God is voting. That when God spoke creation into existence, that God was voting that creation was good. That when God breathed life and we became human beings, that God indeed was voting that we are all equal. I suggest to you, as Dr. Forbes has said, that our voice is indeed our vote, and that we vote every time we speak out. We vote everywhere we go on every issue. Now, Dr. Forbes also talked about 9/11, which everyone agrees was an act of terrorism. But I am a child of the 60s from Birmingham, Alabama. Mm-hmm. And there was another act of terrorism that happened in September. Four little girls were bombed in a church called 16th Street. I remember the anxiety and the angst that come around that day every year. One of those little girls' sister went to school with me. It is also an act of terrorism that this country should do great penance for. Because that act of terrorism, unlike the one on 9/11, is attached to the infected moral aptitude of this country. There is a lie being spread around, and most of us are drinking the Kool-Aid. The lie says that all people are not created equal. The lie says that someone has to win and somebody has to lose. The lie says that God didn't create enough in abundance for all of human creation and all of creation, period, to live in harmony and all be taken care of. The lie says that we don't have enough resources in this country for everyone to make a living wage and for everyone to have a decent quality of life. The lie says that everybody is not due health care, adequate health care, and adequate housing, and adequate food supply. The lie says that the indigenous people of this country should be on Standing Rock fighting for land that was taken from them in the first place. The lie says that women shouldn't have control of their own bodies, but that people who have nothing to do with our reproductive system should care more about our womb than they care about food in our stomachs. The lie says that lesbian, gay, and transgendered people are not considered equal in this country and should not have the same rights and the same benefits afforded for marriage to all. The lie says that the life and the well-being of my child is not as important as the life and the well-being of somebody else's child. The lie says that the government is not a servant of the people, but the government rules the people. The lie says that God is Republican or Democrat when God doesn't give a hoot about your political convictions. The lie says God is American when God cares about the whole world that God has created. And our voice is our vote. Now, the question I pose to you today is, will you be prophets of resistance?
That's it, right?
Or are you going to be priests of an empire?
All right.
That is the question. Mm-hmm. Oh. Some folk are doing what they are supposed to be doing. There is no lie and no hidden agenda in what's coming out in this political election.
That's right.
But my concern is for those of us who have declared that we have been called by a higher power. Those of us who are declaring that God indeed leads and directs our path and our words. My concern is that we have become complicit and infected with this toxin. That I say to you is not just racism. But is the desire to be God. At its core, America's problem is that we have created God in our image rather than serving the image in which we are created. So my friends, there is more at stake for us than any political election.
Yes, yes.
There is more at stake for us than who is in the White House. That matters, but that changes every 8 years. What we are fighting for, what I am marching for, the reason that I'm speaking out is I believe our very soul is on the line.
That's it, that's it.
And if we fail to see the God in every created being, then we will have failed God.
Yeah.
Yeah. Choose ye
this day.
Yeah.
I like it.
Who you will serve.
Yes.
Choose ye whether you will serve the God of capitalism or whether you will serve the God of creation.
Yeah.
Choose ye this day whether you will serve a God of favor or you will serve a God of favoritism. Choose ye this day.
Yes.
I have made my choice. Mm. I pray you've made yours.
And so you clearly hear we'll be joined by rabbis and imams, some who couldn't be here today because we originally had planned this on the 29th, but I had a very close friend to die and we had to go back. But you hear Dr. Forbes, you hear Dr. Blackmon. I'm going to invite in a moment other clergy and members of 515 to stand with us as we take questions. Would you look at this map of all the places we're going to have this day of action and the places we're going with the revival. Now that's, the revival doesn't end November 8th because we do believe we need a revolution of moral values. It's not a moment, it's a movement. We must shock the heart of this nation. Every age has needed what I coined a few weeks ago, moral defibrillators. Whether it was Henry David Thoreau or Frederick Douglass and Harriet Tubman in the 1800s, Sojourner Truth, or whether it was Walter Rauschenbusch and others in the turn of the century, Mary McLeod Bethune, A. Philip Randolph, or whether it was Dr. King or Dorothy Day or Rabbi Heschel. Every age has to have people who say, look, the issue for me is not this false notion of left versus right. We're very concerned about how that has dominated our political discussion. It doesn't even fit this century. It comes from the 17th century, French Revolution. The left didn't want the monarchy, the right wanted to. Why are we doing? People saying, you're liberal, you're conservative. What do you mean? I'm both. I want to liberally spread justice, and I want to conservatively hold on to justice because to conserve means to hold on to the essence of. What do you mean you're an evangelical? What does that really mean? I'm a theological, evangelical, a conservative, liberal, biblicist. And there's a way to define who decided that we had to talk like that. Huh? You know, who decided that as my good friend who wrote America's Original Sin, Jim Wallace, said that evangelicalism, the way it's taught in this country becomes a euphemism for white Christians who believe a certain direction. He said, how can we grab the holiest thing? Well, it's not new. In the 1800s, there was a movement called the Redemption Movement. It sounded very religious, but it actually worked to tear down Reconstruction in this country and tear apart blacks and whites. There's another priest called himself the Southern Strategy right after the death of Dr. King. It sounds good. Southern Strategy might mean you're going to lift up the South, but the goal was to divide the South, to cause blacks and whites to think black people and brown people are their problem and to vote against them. In other words, that black and brown people are not just people with problems, but a problem people. That was the goal of the Southern Strategy. And to line up with a certain and create something called the Solid South. Then you had the Moral Majority. And the goal was to limit the moral discussion, to prayer in the school, abortion, homosexuality, and where you stand on those issues. But that's so contrary to our deepest foundation, our deepest religious values. Somebody will say, well, this is just a progressive agenda. Well, is that too? How can you read Christ and read Moses and not be progressive? Moses was so progressive, he wanted to come out of Egypt in slavery. That's right. Christ was so progressive, he wanted to feed 5,000 and challenge any systems that were about injustice. Yeah, yeah. It's not we moral agenda. There'll be some that will say, well, the first critic you're going to criticize, that costs too much, Raylan. Well, I'm glad there's a Nobel Peace Prize laureate, Joseph Stiglitz, who wrote a book actually called The Price of Inequality. How much does it cost us in money and in morality? Because immoral agendas that hurt people, that are extreme, that do not lift everybody, are constitutionally inconsistent, morally indefensible, but they're also economically insane. It's insane not to have a living wage. And how can you say on the one hand you want people to have jobs, but then you don't want to pay them a living wage, or that the minimum wage is already too high? We've raised from zero. It took us 400 years to get to $7.25. What do you want to do, wait another 400 years? Healthcare is economically sane. It adds jobs. It creates people. The healthcare allows them to be able to work. But I mean, the fact of the matter is what we're talking about is economically sane. Then we hear all this talk about violence. And some people, you know, Traci, Dr. Forbes, want to limit it to. They'll point out a city where there's violence, but not talk about all of the violence that we have perpetrated upon those in poor communities that end up creating systems of violence. That's why I love what Coretta Scott King one time, when somebody asked her, what does she think about violence since her husband was assassinated? And Coretta said, violence is greater than when somebody gets shot. She says, ghetto housing is violence. Denying people education is violence. Poverty is violence. Taking people's culture is violence. Police brutality is violence. Not paying people a living wage or giving them health care is violence. This is correct. Then she said, even an apathetic attitude that doesn't seek to address those issues is a form of violence. And then finally, to the media, yes, we want a conversation about voting, a morality that says, call preachers when you want to talk about economics and banking and health care. Those are moral issues. Don't just call us when somebody wants to talk about prayer in the school. Call us when people want to P-R-E-Y, pray on people in their public policy. And let's have a truth. Because even lastly, this piece on voting, Dr. Forbes mentioned it about representing the image of God. Because you can't vote unless you're a citizen. You can't be a citizen unless you're a person. So if you undermine my right to vote, you're suggesting I'm not a person. It's clear and simple. Praise itself about how God votes. Let me add one piece to that. It is one of the greatest immoral things that are happening right now. Is I come from a state where in the 21st century, in 2016, a governor and a legislator were found guilty of intentional racist discrimination in vote. Not disparate treatment, but intentional. And it happened in Texas. And we have 20 some other states where there are cases going on right now. In a democracy, not we didn't know what was gonna happen, but intentionally. And the fight for voting rights is not just about black people. Voting rights is about labor rights. It's about health care. Because if you don't expand the electorate, then a certain small group of extremists can control the electorate, which is why they tried to narrow the electorate, because they know they can't win if there's a broad electorate. But here's something that is a moral tragedy, and we call on every party. I hope that in this debate season, lastly, and then we'll take questions, there will be one entire debate on voting rights. We've been talking about national security. Yes. We've had a debate on economics. Yeah. Let's have one debate yes. on voting rights. Where do you stand if you run for president, governor? Where do you stand on restoring the Voting Rights Act? Where do you stand on protect? Because how can we go through a whole season asking people to vote for us and not deal with this issue of intentional vote and where people stand? And then we need to look at this. Strom Thurmond only filibustered the 1957 Civil Rights Act for a little bit over 24 hours. That's all not for 24 hours. When I stop counting, this current Congress, since June 25th, 2013, has engaged in a filibuster in congressional, what Dr. King would call interposition and nullification, for more than 1,135 days, when I stop counting. 1,100, that's immoral in a democracy. That the Congress, that is required by the 15th Amendment to protect voting rights, has sat on fixing. And for members of the media, we ought to be talking about that as a moral issue. Talk about economic justice as moral issues, healthcare, education. So we're glad we're moving out on the 12th. You can go to www.moralrevival.org. We've been doing these revivals since April. And the crowds and people are coming out because people understand we need a moral revolution of values. Let me ask brothers and sisters for Fight for 15 that are helping us organize. There are other groups as well, but they're here today to come up. The clergy, if y'all wouldn't mind coming up, standing, and Dr. Forbes and Mrs. Blackmon will stand. We're not going to be long, and see if there are any questions from members of the media. We're not going to do that union stand. Okay, I promise you. But if Dr. Forbes right here, and Traci, if you come right on this side so you can easily move to the mic if necessary. And then the rest of y'all, just come up around. All of us. These people represent thousands across the country. As we said, more than 2,500. You want to come up, Robin? You. Okay. 2,500. Over 2,500 clergy have signed. Thousands of others. I'm glad to have Robin Williams here, one of our great friends. Are there any questions from members of the media? Yes, ma'am. And you are?
Alice Olstein with Think Progress.
Yes.
On the topic of voting rights, some counties in North Carolina are still fighting about early voting, including on Sundays. Can you talk a little bit about why this is an important fight, specifically Sunday voting?
Yeah. Well, it's not some counties. It's boards of elections. And what happened is the federal courts ruled that North Carolina's Governor McCrory and the legislature had engaged in intentional discrimination in a case filed by the NAACP and churches and individuals. It was the biggest case since Shelby, the biggest case since the Voting Rights Act was passed, and we won. And when that happened, however, presidential candidate Trump came to our state in Charlotte and actually said that the courts were now opening up the possibility of fraud. Think about that. The court said this state has been engaged in intentional racial discrimination. A presidential candidate, rather than saying, you know, this is wrong, Governor, you're wrong, we need to repent, you need to do right, said that what the courts did unanimously would now open up fraud. And then he even went further, said it would allow, you know, brown people and illegal immigrants, you know, just that Zena hate you're talking about. That's right. After that, the executive director of the Republican Party sent out a memo. Now, normally we in the civil rights community, we know stuff like this happening, but normally we don't actually have evidence. We surmise, this must be. He sent out a memo that was supposed to be secret, but it became public, telling the Republican members of the Board of Elections to institute voting policies that reflected Republican values, not what the courts have said. Now, actually, they aren't reflecting Republican values either, because that's not what Abraham Lincoln would do or Teddy Roosevelt. So really, what he was really saying is implement extremist values. And so the boards of elections, many of them have done that. And we'll have a big hearing on the 8th, because in North Carolina, you have to have a unanimous vote of all three members But the majority of the boards of elections are determined by whoever the governor is. So the governor is Democrat, too, and if the Republican is, too. So the many Democratic members are voting against these plans because they're trying to, for instance, one of the things they want to do is move all of the voting places off college campuses, especially HBCUs, early voting. The other thing they want to do is shut down all the early voting sites except at the Board of Election, and then only keep it open during working hours. Which the goal of early voting and same-day registration is to be ensured that poor people and other people that can't get off during regular hours will be able to exercise their right to vote in a democracy. They want to end Sunday voting, and some of them even Saturday voting. So we're in a major fight. But that is, as I said, that's what we're talking about. Something's morally wrong with you, with your thinking, when in a democracy, you work to suppress and undermine the vote. Something's wrong with that. And we're deeply concerned, as Dr. Blackmon said, that you know, we hear people holler a lot about prayer in the school, but where are you when people are praying on people's voting right? P-R-E-Y. Where are you when people are praying on people's wages? That's a serious question in this democracy. Any others? In September the 8th in North Carolina. I don't know about other places, but in North Carolina specifically, the State Board of Election meets. And they have to have a hearing on all of these plans that were not voted on unanimously. So our lawyers and others will be there.
Can you explain for folks who don't know why Sunday voting is important for the faith community?
Well, it's important, first of all of the rules that we talk about, Sunday voting, same day registration, early voting, we won those through movement. Forward Together, Moral Movement, HKMJ, people in the NAACP, Democracy, North Carolina. We fought for years. We challenged Democrats. Because as somebody said, God is not Democrat or Republican. We challenged Democrats. And we won those things because, remember, we did not get protected voting rights until 1965, August 6, 1965. North Carolina did not have an African American to return to the Congress until 1990. So it was 25 years after the Voting Rights Act that North Carolina as a southern state once again had one African-American in the United States Congress. We had to fight all kinds of oppositions that went on from 65. And by the 90s, we got early voting, and then in 2007, got same-day registration, early voting, Sunday voting. Many churches, many African-American congregations, according to the statistics, would use Sunday voting in honor of Bloody Sunday. The argument of many black and white progressive congregations and Jewish would say, if we were beat on a Sunday and bloodied on a Sunday, we ought to cast our ballot on a Sunday. Mm-hmm. Well, it worked. And more than a million black and brown people showed up at the poll through an early voting and same day registration in 2008. Once that happened, in our state, once that happened in our state, and it's in other states as well, all of a sudden folks said there's fraud. When black and brown people started voting in mass numbers, and the black vote in North Carolina went to 70%, and black women were higher than any other demographic. And it started happening particularly around the South, because if you get 30% of African Americans to register and vote in the South beyond what you have, it's no longer a solid South, which opens up those 11 Southern states, which opens up the American democracy, because it's 160 electoral votes in just those 11 states. All of a sudden, fraud was claimed, even when there was no fraud. And the goal was, and these legislators, lastly, they requested from the Board of Election before they voted on this voter suppression law, give us the statistics of how black people use different rules. And the ones that black and brown people use the most were the very ones that they tried to remove, which is why the court said it was surgical and intentional racism. Tracy.
I just wanted to speak very directly to your specific question. When you live in a country with economic inequity, there are certain ways that shows up in neighborhoods of marginalized people. And so I believe that as a country, we should be born with the right to vote.
Exactly.
We should have to lose it. No one had me register to pay taxes. They figured that out, right? And so every way that we can mobilize people to vote is important. In the last two national elections in St. Louis, I've led a voting right mobilization effort because the economic impact of people's ability to have transportation, their ability to be connected with other people who are voting, is all impacted. And so when we as faith communities begin to mobilize people on Sundays, we're able to take our buses and our vans and take people from the pews to the polls. That's why it's important. And anyone who is concerned about the democracy in this country should be celebrating that more people have the opportunity to vote than less. If you work a minimum wage job, and many of the people I know who work minimum wage jobs work more than one, mm-hmm. because you can't live off of the salary of one of those jobs. It is hard for you to have time to get off and vote, even if the law says they're supposed to let you off, right? And so whatever day that you are off, if you can go and vote on that day, it matters. And if we want everyone's voice to be heard, we should be a country that is about making it easy to get to the polls and not hard to get to the polls. So the question becomes, what are you gaining by not helping people make it to the polls? Follow the money. When you follow the money, you'll have your answer. And as a faith community, it is incumbent upon us to mobilize every bus, every van, every car to make it happen. The last presidential election, we drove someone to the polls who had not voted in the last four elections simply because he did not have transportation. We took people who could not read. Just because you can't read doesn't mean you can't vote.
That's right.
We took people who couldn't see. Register people who have paid their who have been convicted of crimes, have worked their sentence, have paid their debt. They should be able to vote. That's why it's important. Because anytime you find people trying to stop something, it's because they know the power of it.
We hear a lot these days about making America great. I think it's important when we talk about voting to say if you wanted to measure how exceptional a nation is or how great it is, one of the indices of greatness has got to be what is the percentage of people who are citizens of your country, who believe that their voice matters, who have an investment in the outcome of the welfare and well-being of that nation. So I think we've got to recognize, you really want to be great, think about our VQ. That is, what is the voting quotient? And the higher the voting quotient, perhaps the greater the nation. You suppress the vote, you, in a sense, are robbing your nation of the greatness that you talk about or claim that you aspire to.
And you understand why. You hear this articulation from Dr. Blackmon. In our moral declaration, it's not just about feel good. It's about policy. And that's one thing we want to drive home, because a lot of times what we see in the current arena is if somebody happens to just shake hands with a preacher, or pray for him, hold that. No. You can say, Lord, Lord, with your mouth, but your heart or the heart of your policy, it be far from the moral standards of that we know are to be true. You can, the Bible clearly says where your treasure is, not where your heart is, where your treasury is. She just mentioned, follow the money. Where your treasure is, that's where your heart is. So in this declaration, what will happen on that day, an impacted person, say impacted by voter suppression, will tell their story. And then a clergy will read our higher ground policy moral declaration. In it includes that we should be registered automatically. You're registered for the draft automatically. But we also should be protecting and expanding the Voting Rights Act right now. Because today, Attorney General Lynch, this is a deep moral issue. I think about it all the time. We've had two African-American attorney generals in the history of this country. We have the first female African-American attorney general. We had a black African-American male attorney general. After 2013, both of them had less power to enforce the Voting Rights Act than the attorney general had August 7, 1965. That, when we talk about Sunday voting, some people could walk to their polls. Let's walk out of Congress. Now there are groups trying to take that away and trying to undermine and suppress the right to vote. And lastly, I always make this point. I want to make it on CNN, and if there are no other questions, we'll stop here. I mean, on C-SPAN. We can talk all we want to about this challenge, but if you look at where the voter suppression has gone on in law since 2013, all you have to do is look at the states that have had an increase in African-American votes and Latino votes. And one other dynamic, where African-American Latinos and progressive whites have figured out how to come together, poor whites. Where there is a potential for that, because that is the coalition that can fundamentally shift American politics. Dr. King knew it, we know it. So wherever you've seen that potential, so for instance, if you look at the South, while it's happened in other places, but I wanna explain something here on C-SPAN, then we'll stop. If you take North Carolina, Virginia, South Carolina, Georgia, Mississippi, Alabama, Florida, Tennessee, Kentucky, Arkansas, Texas, and Louisiana. If you can control those states with a limited moral message, that's called the Bible Belt, and all that you talk about that you ought to be concerned about of a candidate is where they stand on prayer and abortion and whatnot. If you can get people to accept that, certain folk to accept it, that's the moral agenda. If you can fool people to think that those people, black and brown people, are the ones that are costing you jobs, people getting free stuff, which was the goal of the Southern Strategy and Strom Thurmond group, because they get free entitlements, then that's undermining your economic sustainability, which in fact, you need those same things. But if you can convince people, particularly working class and poor whites, and then you can suppress the vote, you control over 160 electoral votes. You control nearly 50% of the United States Senate and over 31% of the United States House of Representatives, and you haven't even gotten to the other 35 states. So this is about. Flip that over. If you can get people to understand that morality is more than those three things, and understand it's about economics and poverty and living wages and health care and voting rights, and if you can get blacks and whites and poor whites and blacks and Latino to understand their commonality, that they're not enemies, and that if they work together, they can determine how policy is set that will help uplift all communities, and if you can ensure that the vote are not suppressed, and you liberate those states, you free up this democracy. It's time for a moral revival and a revolution of moral values in this country. Thank you. Any more media? We got to run. They're telling us we got to get out. Thank you so much for being here today, and please feel free to talk to any persons individually. God bless you. See you on September 12th.